safe within your name. This we know, this we know. You promise never to forsake. What you began, you will sustain. This we know, this we know.
Freedom is ours. Good morning, everyone, and welcome. My name is Eric O'Connell. I am the high school and post-high pastor here at Hillside Community Church. Just want to say welcome. Thank you for joining us and worshiping with us this morning. It's our joy to have you. If you are new here this morning, if you've been visiting or have not had an opportunity to get connected here at Hillside, we'd love to chat with you after the service. You can talk to myself, Pastor Ron, anyone leading worship on stage, and we'd love to just get to know you, hear your story, and hopefully connect you to worshiping life here at Hillside just this morning. We don't have many announcements this morning, but one important reminder, out in the Welcome Center, or by the coffee, somewhere out there, there's going to be Daniel's book. Pastor Daniel is going to be moving on to Cragmore CRC in Colorado, and we'd love to send him home with some encouragement and some mementos. So if you'd like to offer a word of encouragement or share a memory or just say something nice in Daniel's book, we'd love for you to take that opportunity after the service. Other than that, we don't have any other announcements. So if you are able to, would you please stand to receive a word greeting from the Lord? God has brought us all here this morning. It's our great joy to worship Him and praise Him. And as we come to do that, our God greets us with these words, grace and peace from God our Father and from His Son and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Now that God has greeted us, would you please take a moment to look around the auditorium and welcome everyone else and let them know Jesus loves them, and then let's get to worshiping.
Good morning. One of the glories of the gospel is that because of Jesus Christ, we all have access to the throne room of God. He has conquered the grave, freed every captive, broken all of our chains. He is faithful. Let's come before Him together now and worship.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great. Chain, oh God, you have done great. do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Chain of God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. You have done great things. Oh, God, you do. My praise. When I was down, you
together. Father, we come and we give you thanks for all you have done. We stop and just think about how amazing all the things that you've done for us. We think of creation, the sun and the moon and the stars, and summer in Michigan, the beauty of lakes and streams and rivers and trees. And we give you thanks for your creation. We give you thanks for what you've done in salvation, that Jesus Christ died for us, that all our sins can be washed away when we hide ourselves in him. And your faithfulness, we give you thanks for all the battles that have been won. Father, we give you thanks for where you've been and how you've been with us. But Father, we also give thanks, and we just reflect for a couple of moments here on who you are. We recognize that you are amazing. You are beautiful beyond description. You are powerful, and you are holy. And glory surrounds you. And Father, as we think about your holiness, we recognize our own sinfulness. And again, we just stop and thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ and the forgiveness of all our sins. Remind us of that grace. Remind us of that so that we can come into the presence of your holiness and just enjoy your beauty. And so we thank you for who you are, for your holiness, your glory, and we give ourselves to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you join us as we continue singing?
Hope is in you only.
one another. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
My heart.
may be seated.
Just one note before we go to prayer. A week from tomorrow, Tom Dykema's memorial will be held. If you would like to attend, if you're interested in that, you can find the details of that in the bulletin. Let's pray together. Lord, we offer our hearts to you, God, now in prayer. You have called us here. You have given us breath. You have drawn us into your presence. And it's our great joy, it's our honor and privilege to be able to give you back that breath in worship this morning. God, as we reflect on your glory, it's our joy to join creation in singing Christ be magnified. It's because of Christ alone, God, that we can stand before you in your presence with confidence. God, on our own, all we know how to do is to bow down to idols. God, by our own strength, we don't chase after truth, but God, we foolishly run towards death and sin over and over again. God, we confess that without Jesus, we are hopeless to save ourselves and lost in our sin. But God, we praise you this morning that out of your great love and grace, you have not left us without hope. God, by the blood of Jesus, you wash away our sins and you make us clean. And through the power of your Spirit and by Jesus' resurrection, you've transformed our hearts. And God, you've given us the greatest gift in being a new creation. God, for all this, again, we proclaim with joy, Christ be magnified. You, Jesus, are our hope, our joy, our purpose, and our reason for worship. God, but we don't want our worship to just be confined to this space and to this time alone. God, by the power of your Spirit, would you shape our hearts and equip us to worship you outside these walls, God, to continue to serve you. Lord, as we go into our homes, our workplaces, and communities, God, would we be reminded constantly of your great love and service to us when we were your enemies? And God, by the power of your Spirit, would you empower us to offer the same love and service to those that we come in contact with? God, empower us to lay down our lives so that we may find true and abundant life in you. And as we follow your leading, God, we pray that we would see our homes, our workplaces, our communities, and the world changed and transformed, God, more into your kingdom's likeness and for your glory. Lord, we do pray for those in our family and our community, God, who need prayer, for those dealing with health issues, chronic illness, God, disease and injury. We ask for healing, for comfort, and for peace. God, we pray that you would be with Rachel Cunnan as she recovers from hypoglycemia. God, we pray that you would be with the Roersma family, especially Troy as he recovers from surgery. God, and we pray that you would be with our little Layton down in Florida as she continues to grow. God, all of them face many difficulties. Each day brings ups and downs. And Lord, we ask that your healing hand would be at work. And as they recover or as they continue to battle with health issues, God, we pray that you would grant them strength, peace, and comfort. God, for those dealing with the loss of loved ones, we pray that you would grant them strength and the assurance of your presence. And Lord, as our nation and our communities continue to deal with new COVID outbreaks, God, we pray for safety. We pray for wisdom. We pray for health. We pray that these new outbreaks, God, that they wouldn't tear us apart, God, but by your power and by your Spirit, we would be more unified in our love for you and for others. God, hear our prayers. Lord, and as we turn our hearts towards your word, we pray that your Spirit would speak mightily through Pastor Ron. Thank you for his passion for your word. Thank you for the many ways that you have gifted him to preach your word. God, and as we continue to discover this freedom that you have offered us in your commandments, God, mold us, shape us more into your likeness. We love you, Lord, and we desire to hear what you have to say to us through your word this morning. So speak, because your servants are listening. And all this we pray in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And all God's people said, amen.
Thank you, Eric. My name is Ron Cool. I'm one of the pastors here at Hillside. Welcome to all of you. Welcome to those of you who are joining us online. Before we get into anything sermon, just a reminder that there are several ways to give here at Hillside. We don't pass the plates right now, so we forget to mention that. There are baskets by the doors. Again, you can do text giving. You can do online giving in other ways. So just a reminder of that. We are told we don't remind you enough. So really, I hate to talk about money, but if I have to, I have to. All right, enough of that. We're going to continue looking at the Ten Commandments this morning, and we're up to the Eighth Commandment, all right? We're going to read two passages of Scripture, one from the Old Testament, one from the New Testament. Both are just one verse long. Old Testament, Exodus 20, verse 15, you shall not steal. You shall not steal. New Testament, Ephesians 4, verse 28, all right? Uh-oh, we're not talking to each other again. All right, they're working on that. Ephesians 4, verse 28 says this: he who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with his own hands, that he may have something to share with those in need. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We're going to continue to go through these commandments the way we have the other ones in this series. We're going to talk about, well, what is it talking about? Why did God give us? How does it set us free? And then how do we carry it out? Those three things: what, why, and how. But before we get there, this morning I want to make three preliminary comments, all right? Three preliminary comments. And the first one that I want to make is this. It's that this is a commandment that almost everyone agrees with. Some commandments, you know, some people say, I don't buy that. If I'm not a Christian, I shouldn't have to listen to that or whatever. But this is a commandment that pretty well everybody across the board, right? There's very few people who say, well, if you steal something of mine, you know, then shame on me, so just keep it, right? No, if you steal it, it's wrong, give it back to me. And pretty well every person agrees with it. And I think most of us do a pretty good job at one level of keeping this commandment. But one of the things I need to say at the beginning so that you'll try to maybe stay interested is this, in that this is also a commandment that many of us really struggle with more than we'd like to admit. Again, at one level, it's fairly easy. We're not going to go into our neighbor's house and grab his TV. We're not going to go to a car lot and steal a car. We're not going to embezzle $20,000 from the company, right? And it's at one level, this is really fairly easy to keep. But the reality is, at deeper levels, there's a more subtle way of stealing, and we'll talk about what those are, but we feel that pressure, and we might just fudge a little on our taxes. We might just borrow a little from work that we intend to repay. There are any number of ways, and we'll talk about those, but what I want to introduce at this point is just saying, you know, in order to understand that temptation to steal, I think it comes from one of two motives for many of us. Maybe there are others. But part of where I think we can feel pressure to steal is because of fear. When we fear that we won't have enough. Imagine that you're facing retirement and you go, oh my goodness, I thought I'd be in a different situation. I thought we had everything all set. I thought we'd be able to live in the same stuff, and we haven't. You're 60 years old and you realize that. And I'll tell you, you'll start to look at things and say, well, maybe I can expense this. Maybe I could get reimbursed for this. Maybe I don't have to report this income. Maybe we can make some more money this way. And all of a sudden, you start finding yourself playing around with those edges of stealing and sometimes crossing the line over. You're afraid that you won't be able to live that way. Maybe you have an investment that goes bad. And it's like, man, I was a fool. I put too much into this. I know I can get it back. But for right now, I just need to get some extra cash. How can I do that? And you feel that pressure. By the grace of God, I've not been in this situation, but some of you have. If you're afraid that you can't make your next house payment, and you're homeless, looking at homelessness rather, you're not able to make the next apartment pay. Friends, don't sit here and say, I would never steal, until you think about living with your kids out on the street. And in that situation, you're going, well, what do? I got to get, or if you can't feed your kids. At that time, you start to feel a pressure in a whole different way. When you fear that you're not going to be able to have enough, when you fear that something's going to have to change. For some of us, that's what can drive us to stealing, to playing with the edges of how we get stuff or how we keep stuff. The other motive, I think, that acts as a temptation, the other drive inside of us that can act as a temptation is desire. And again, I know some people who don't desire anything, but most of us desire, well, just a little more. Just a little nicer stuff. Wherever we are, we tend to want just a little, you know, I just want to be able to have a car that runs. I just want to be able to paint the house. I just want to be able to get a little bigger house. I just want to be able to get a boat. I mean, the kids are going to have so much fun. And because of that desire, because, you know, we want a little bit more, we start to, again, look at the edges. We start to play around with stealing. We start to play around with keeping stuff that we should get. Maybe if we don't give to church for 6 months, then we can get this. Right? That's why I say that this is something we struggle with more than we'd like to admit. Like I say, not with going and getting your neighbor's TV, but with dealing with those fears and those desires and then playing games. And then the third thing, just preliminary, is that this is a commandment that we are just amazing at being able to rationalize. Right? I mean, everybody's doing it. Everybody's doing it. Nobody reports all their income to the IRS, okay? Nobody does. In fact, they know that, so they set the numbers high, right? And so they assume we're going to cheat. So if I don't cheat, if I do report all my income, I'm actually paying more than I should. It's my American obligation to lower that amount, right? I mean, we get into these rationalizations that Sam Walton will never miss a toaster. I mean, come on. They charged me so much for this hotel room, I'm assuming that the towels are included. I mean, it's got to be that. That's what it, because it's not that night. I mean, I can just, and we rationalize in unbelievable ways, and we'd say, I never steal anything. I am not a crook. And yet we break this commandment. We rationalize breaking it in so many ways. All right, kind of to get us going. So let's ask our questions. What? First of all, what is this commandment calling us to? Okay, what is it challenging us to think about? Tim Keller, he talks about this, and he says there are two ways that we can steal. And the first one is the more common one, and it's the one that we would probably think of first. And it's by getting something that's really not ours. And so the commandment says, don't get things in the wrong way. Don't get things in the wrong way. This is about possession and ownership. Don't get stuff in the wrong way. Again, there are different levels of this. At the easiest level, the top level, it's outright taking what belongs to someone else. That's what we classically call stealing, right? It's yours, but I take it. TV, cars, clothes, towels from hotels, money, etc. Any of that stuff. Most of us are going to say, good, I have never done those things. I had nice towels at one hotel. I thought about it, but I didn't. All right, so, I mean, right, but what about computer programs and downloaded music or movies? Oh, come on, Ron, that's so small. That's nothing. It's just a bunch of ones and zeros, and I don't have anything, and I know I'm going to get sick of the song in 2 months. You seriously expect me to pay for the song knowing that in 2 months I'm going to just delete it and not want to hear it anymore? That's stupid. It belongs to somebody else. And we're taking it. That's stealing when we take that. Thoughts, ideas without giving credit. Plagiarism. We think about that in school. Yep, there. I think about it in sermons. Yep, sometimes it happens there with pastors. It's really interesting. You don't read all the same stuff I do. But it's so tempting to plagiarize. Don't have enough time this week. So I'll just... But you got to give credit. You got to give credit. But even in a workplace, think about it. Have you ever been in a situation where you had a great idea and you went to your supervisor and you say, hey, I think this would work, and your supervisor goes to their supervisors and says, hey, I got a great idea. You go, time out, hold on, that was my idea. You stole my idea. That's theft. People do that to us. We do that to others when we don't give credit for those ideas. So there's outright taking what belongs to someone else. Some of that, I think, is challenging for some of us. I think the next one is also challenging for us, maybe even more so. And it's, we get things the wrong way when we deceive others or when we cheat someone. Let's say you're a painter and you say, I'm going to use this quality of paint. And the owner says, yep, that's what I want. I want this quality of paint. Now, you know, there's really not that much difference. And the person will never tell once it's on the walls. And so you use this quality of paint. You still charge for this quality of paint. I mean, they won't know. It's not a big deal. Besides, did you see the size of the house? They can afford this. And my family needs it. And so it's really not stealing. It's just creative marketing or something. I don't know what. But we do that. You have a car you're going to sell. Hey, buyer beware. I know it's going to break, but buyer beware. You know what? This commandment is here, so buyers don't have to beware if they're dealing with Christians, with God's people. Everybody should know, oh, you're a God follower? Then I don't have to be buyer beware, because I know you're going to tell me the truth. You're not going to steal. You're not going to cheat. There are just so many ways that we can do this when we are in business settings, as owners, as workers, and as receivers. The Bible talks about this one a lot. Look at Proverbs 11, verse 1. It says, the Lord detests dishonest scales, but accurate weights find favor of them. God detests this, that people play games with scales and with cheating each other. What does it look like? Here, let me just tell you. Let's imagine you're going to bake some bread. You're back in Old Testament times. You're going to bake some bread, all right? And so you need wheat. You got to grind your own wheat. You need wheat. You go to the market and you find the grain man and you go and you say, I need 8 shekels of wheat. He's going to pull out his scale. God says, make sure it's a fair scale. And then he's going to pull out his weights. And the 8 shekel one is the one that's the farthest on the left. This is actually from like 600 some BC in Israel. So it's 8 shekels is what it's kind of carved into there. Puts the 8 shekel one on one side, starts to put grain on the other side. When it evens out, you say, here you go. Thank you very much. Believe it or not, somebody figured out that you can make a 7.5 shekel weight look a lot like an 8 shekel weight. And you can convince somebody, yeah, this is 8, right? This is my 8. And every time you're stealing 0.5 shekel. Every time you're doing it a little bit short. Every time the package isn't quite full. Right? Ever get frustrated by buying more air than product? God says, I detest that. And again, it started from the first sin, and it continues in a variety of ways. This is a Saturday Evening Post cover from 1936. And the prim and proper woman there on the left, who I'm sure would not be caught saying a naughty word, looks holy as she pushes up on the scale, while the gentleman who probably sits behind her at church looks just innocent as he's pushing down on the scale. And we laugh because it's kind of funny, but it's a reality that we're stealing from each other. We're doing the damage that stealing does, even in little things like this, and we'll talk about why in a minute. Excuse me. The Lord detests, Proverbs 20:23, and there are a bunch of these that talk about this. Detests differing weights, dishonest scales do not please him, okay? Amos, the prophet, I mean, he was frustrated with Israel. He brings God's word to Israel, and he's talking to those who are business people. This one's aimed specifically there. And they look religious. On the Sabbath, they don't work. On the new moon, they don't work. They sit and they look very religious. But Amos says, in your hearts, this is what they're thinking. This is what they're thinking in their hearts. When will the new moon be over that we may again sell grain? When the Sabbath be ended that we may market wheat? When can we get back to it, right? Now again, there's working hard and that's good. I like that. But there's, I'm going to go through this so I look like this, but in reality, my head and my heart is ready to make the deal. And the kind of deals they make. Amos goes on, he says, skimping on the measure, it's a bushel. Well, it's a small bushel, but it's a bushel. and boosting the price, cheating with dishonest scales, buying the poor with silver and the needy for a pair of sandals, verse 6, selling even the sweepings with the wheat. Again, you think that like filler is a new topic? You buy beef hot dogs with other meat product in them? This has been going on forever. You take the grain, you put the grain, you're supposed to have just the grain there, you leave some chaff in it, you can't get it perfect, so there you go. No. God says, if you're using filler, you're stealing. You're deceiving others. So that's just, we get things that way. And again, it's really tempting to come up with 1,000 reasons why. Well, the market is down this year. Well, grain is up this year. Well, this is whatever. But it's stealing, price gouging. Again, Amos says, boosting the price. Now, we live in a free market economy. I respect that. Again, I got brothers and dad's business and so on, all that stuff in the free market economy. But there's a place where we say, hold on. And especially the Bible makes it clear that for people in need. I think that we have to recognize biblically, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but if we rip off people in need, it's worse than ripping off somebody who's really rich. You shouldn't rip off anybody, okay? Don't get me wrong in that. But God's heart is especially with those who are in need. And so boosting the price, taking advantage, price gouging of situations where people have no other options. Now, again, something is worth what you can sell it for, but some things, I think we got to say, no, you can't do that with this because people need it and you're taking advantage of it. All right. And another way we get is not giving our employees what we should. I get paid for an 8-hour day. I work four and mess around for four. I tell them I made 20 calls, get paid for 20 calls, I made five. That's stealing. You're getting paid for something. You're getting money for something you never did. So that's part of it. Don't get things in the wrong way. The other part of it that Keller points to is don't keep things in the wrong way. We can steal, and this, again, it gets a little harder to see because, look, it's mine. I'm not stealing it. It's mine. Right. But you may owe it to somebody else, and if you keep it, it's unfair. If you owe somebody something, pay them on time. I don't know, again, I'm not a business guy myself, and I'm sure my brothers would never do something like this, but I've heard of companies that say, yeah, our contract says 30 days, but we never pay for 60. They're only going to scream at 90. So we're just going to know we're going to be... No! You owe it. You're stealing, right? And you may be able to carry the cash, but what about the person who can't? Pay it on time. We should provide for our employees what is right. Just as I owe an honest day's work for an honest day wage, so an employer owes an honest day wage for an honest day work. Again, I'm not going to get into, I don't know exactly how we determine what that all is, but I'm just saying, friends, be careful, because if you are just saying, I don't have to give benefits, I'm never going to do that, or if you're just trying to find all sorts of way to, and it takes advantage of people, God says you're stealing. Be honest on your taxes. And then the fourth one, that this is one I think that is really biblical, but we don't think about it at all. But I think in the Bible, you'll see that it's brought together with stealing, and that is we should give what we have to those in need. We should give our whatever percentage, but give to those in need. Let me kind of try to give you a picture of this. Bible is clear. God calls us to be stewards of all the stuff that he has given to us, right? A steward is somebody, I don't own anything that I have that has my name on it, that's my property. God owns all of it, but he has given it to me to manage, to care for, to nurture, to grow, and to share with others. Part of what God calls us to do is, and I think he does it intentionally, that God gives us stuff, but he calls us to give it to others, to share it with others, because there is such joy in that. So imagine this, and I think God does this intentionally. It's not just a result of sin. Five people, God's going to give them stuff. Now, if God was like most of us when we're parents, and maybe it's best as parents, you can decide yourself. But if God is going to do this, if we were going to do this, what we think God might do is give everybody exactly the same. Everybody gets exactly the same, and nobody has to steal, and nobody has to feel jealous, and everybody has everything, just what they need, and it's all exactly the same. I don't think God does that. And I think he did it. I'll talk to you about Genesis 2 if you want me to. Not today. But I think in the Garden of Eden he did this. Because I think God wants us to learn to live together. What God did is God gives some of us more stuff. Some of us this stuff. Some of us that stuff. Like in the body in the New Testament, the spiritual gifts. God gives different gifts to different people. Why? So we need each other. So we can live in community. So that we can share. And I think God looks down and he says, okay, so-and-so needs that. I'm going to give it to Ron and then Ron's going to give it to them. And if I don't pass it on, I'm the one who's stealing. I'm keeping what doesn't belong to me. And I think that's so clear. With the Bible, the opposite of stealing is being generous. Don't keep what God intends to give you to give to somebody else. Let me show it to you in Scripture. Leviticus 23, verse 22 says this. It says, suppose you are gathering your crops, then do not harvest all the way to the edges of your field, and do not pick up the grain you missed. Leave some for the poor people and the outsiders who live among you. I am the Lord your God. You own a field. You have every legal right to get every bit of grain out of there. You have every right. You're not, well, by the law, you're not stealing. But God says, here's the deal. I want you to leave the edges uncut. I want you to leave the corners open. Because some of your field, actually, I want to go to some people who are in need. And those corners, I want to be for people who are hungry. And I think God continues to do that. God might give it to me, but somebody else needs bread. Somebody else needs this. And we have the joy. Part of the joy of stewardship is the joy of sharing that with others. And we learn the humility of accepting from others. That's really hard as well. Ezekiel 18 talks about a righteous person. He does not oppress anyone, but returns what he took and pledged for a loan. All right? So doesn't steal. But, you take a coat for loan in those days. Person pays back. I'll get your coat to you next week. No, right now. Give it back. He doesn't do that. And then, again, notice the connection here between robbery and giving. He does not commit robbery, but gives his food to the hungry and provides clothing for the naked. And I'll tell you, there's something here about saying that if you're not giving, it's robbery. If you're not sharing, it's robbery. Now, again, there are complexities to figure out how to do this and so on. We can talk about those things. But the general idea, I think, in Scripture is clear. That's what Paul's talking about in Ephesians 4, verse 28. Anyone who has been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands. Why? That they may have something to share with those in need. That they may have something. It's not just that you stop stealing, but get to work. Why? So that you can give to people who are in need. Tim Keller looks at this and he says, you've not stopped being a thief when you've stopped taking. You stop being a thief when you start giving. I think that's the biblical truth. We need to give. If we never share, if we never give to those in need, we're keeping what we shouldn't keep, and we're stealing from whoever God wanted it to go to. We're stewards, and it's His. So don't get things in the wrong way. Don't keep things in the wrong way. All right, we'll go a little faster through the next two. Why? Why does God give us this command? What's important about it? What's the damage that stealing does? How does it put us in jail? How does it put us in maybe literally, but just ruin our lives, put our lives in the ditch? First of all, stealing damages our relationship with God. It damages our relationship with God because when we steal, we're saying, one of two things, or maybe both. We're saying, God, we don't trust you enough that you can provide. God, I have to do this on my own. I have to cut corners on this. I have to lie on my taxes. I have to, steal in this way or that way. I have to claim these expenses that are not real expenses because I don't think you're going to come through for me. I don't trust you. And we put ourselves distant from God. The other thing we're saying is God hasn't given us enough. God is not taking care of us the way He should. And so I don't need more just because I don't have enough. I deserve nicer stuff. I'm a better Christian than that person. Why do they have more income than me? And that damages our relationship with God when we play those games and we say, God, we're saying, God, I don't trust you. Second, stealing damages other people, especially those in need, right? I'm taking something that's yours, and you probably needed it. You needed it to pay bills. You needed it for whatever. And if I'm not paying a fair wage or whatever it is, I'm taking something that somebody else needs. Stealing damages community. God intends us to live in communities of trust and of knowing that we can be honest with each other. Can you imagine living in a community where no one ever stole? Can you imagine knowing that you don't have to, negotiate contracts. I think about it. Andy and I were talking this week as we talked to some folks about adding new staff members here, replacing some of the folks who've gone. And it's like, can we really be honest with each other? Do we really trust that we're honest with each other? This is in the church. But we kind of struggle sometimes because it's like we know how the game is played. We don't want to show too many of our cards. We've done our best to try really to be honest with everybody we're dealing with here. But it's so interesting how that's, again, where it comes out. Stealing damages community. We need to be able to trust each other. Stealing damages our Christian witness. You may be in your workplace, and you may think nobody notices. People do. They notice that you pray before you eat, and they notice that you steal product all the time. And they say, whatever you're praying to, I don't want any part of it. It damages our witness. And then the last one, it's a little more philosophical, but I think this gets really more deeper to the root of it. It robs people. It doesn't just damage them paying their bills, but it robs people of the dignity and joy of stewardship. Let me tell you what I'm talking about here. Again, we're stewards. We manage something. And there's something dignified about doing that, right? Think of a child who's given the responsibility to water the flowers. There's pride, right? Mom and Dad trusted me enough. I take ownership of this, right? And it goes on. One of my neighbors is the head groundskeeper at Aquinas College. Friday night, we're out talking, and he's like, I take great pride in that. Legitimately, he said, but he said, man, that's mine. It's got to look good. So if it doesn't, tell me, and I'll tell him. But it was just fascinating. I didn't prime it at all. He just gave this. I thought, can you speak in church on Sunday? Right? There's a dignity. We talk about the dignity of owning a home. The dignity of all that. When you steal, you're robbing somebody of that dignity. That God-created dignity. That God-given dignity. You know, so often we say, stealing is taking what isn't ours. Change that to taking what belongs to somebody else. I mean, there's always at the end of the day a person at the end of it. A person created in God's image. And you're taking away the dignity of stewardship and the joy of stewardship. When we are given stuff by God, some of it is just the enjoyment of it, to smell the flowers, to eat the basil that we've grown. And you come and steal my basil, I don't get to enjoy it. But also the joy of giving it. The great joy of sharing it. Can you imagine, if somebody comes and steals your kids' flowers they've been growing for Mother's Day? I mean, you're going to be mad that the flowers, you can go get the flowers. But it was the joy that these were the flowers that he grew, that she grew. And the joy of sharing that. So stealing does that. It robs people of the dignity of that. So again, real quick, it damages our relationship with God. It damages other people. It damages community. It damages our witness. And it robs people of the dignity and joy of stewardship. So how can we grow in this? How can we get better at keeping this command? I want to suggest, again, four things here, but they'll be quick. First, take an honest look at our actions. I hope you've been doing that already, because again, this week was not fun for me, because I realized how many times I want to steal, how many times I really want just a little bit more, how many times it would be so nice if I had a car that ran better, how many times I think, man, it'd be so nice if we had new drapes here, it'd be so nice if I had this, it'd be so nice. Take an honest look at your actions. And then where you've failed, confess it and let it go. But just say, God, I'm sorry. And then second, remember that God will provide. Okay? It's not always what we want, but what we need. Paul says in Philippians 4, my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory in Christ Jesus. God will provide. God, okay, so I don't need this. God will take care of me, and I don't have to play games. I don't have to push the boundaries here. Third thing, and this is kind of a fun one, I think, because it's really hard to do, but compare down, not up. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that is most of us, when we look at what other people have, we look at people who have more than us, right? When we drive through neighborhoods, we don't drive through neighborhoods like ours. We drive through the neighborhood one above ours to see how nice those houses are, to see how nice their lawns look, to see their beautiful landscaping. And we do that, and we go to stores, and it's like, wow. We look at people's income, and we always compare up. Guess what? That nurtures our desires. That nurtures our greed. That makes us feel like it's unfair that we don't have more than we have. What if we learn to compare down? What if we drove through neighborhoods where people don't have as much as we do? Not so we can feel superior, but so we can stop and just say, oh, God, I'm so sorry, man. You have given me so much. Look at all the people who have less than you have. Again, I look at it, and I can, you know, I got brothers who are car dealers, and yeah, they barely make any money, honest. I think, why didn't I do that? But I know a lot of people who make a ton less than I do. The more I spend time talking about how much my brothers have, the less joy I have. And the more I'm desiring more stuff, the more I recognize, wow, can you believe the house I live in? I mean, we got a pool in the backyard. I mean, so compare down, not up, and you'll find more joy, and you'll be happier. Remember, related to that, remember this stuff will not make me happy. Okay, Jesus alone can bring me true joy. That's what I need. That's what I need more than anything else. I'm such a fool. I think that really, if I buy this or this or this, I'll be happy. And it never works. So let's wrap it up here. Friends, stuff is good. Material things aren't evil. God gives them to us as gifts to enjoy, to share, to do all sorts of things with, okay? And we should enjoy those things. We should celebrate those things. And so let's take care of it. Let's enjoy it. And let's give it away. The alternative to stealing is being amazingly, joyfully generous. That's where the good life is. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this gift of reminding us that when we steal, we don't win, we lose. It doesn't bring us joy ultimately, and it doesn't bring you joy, and it doesn't bring others joy. So give us hearts of contentment. Give us hearts of stewardship that are thankful and grateful for what you've given to us and to share. Give us open hands, Father, to share what you have given to us with those who might need it, to use it, whatever. Just, Father, you created us with this amazing ability to nurture stuff, but also to share it. Give us the joy and the dignity of being good stewards of what you've given to us and not taking what belongs to somebody else. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to stand and sing the doxology as a response.
Sing with me.
Praise and glory to the Father. Praise and glory to the Son.
From this place, know that the grace, the amazing grace that gives life of our Lord Jesus Christ goes with you. Live in gratitude and generosity. Amen.
The same God who's never late is working all things out.